So, every year at Christmas time, we hear the same familiar story about that night Christ was born. There are many books written on this topic. For adults and children too, there are many songs about the night that Christ was born. Liturgies, poems, plays, movies, and sermons too. Is there even anyone here who's never heard the Christmas story? There isn't, is there, right? Is there anyone who has not heard of Joseph and Mary and the baby Jesus? Of Bethlehem, the star, the shepherds, and the wise men? We've all heard of those, right? Well, sometimes I find myself worried about this very important story becoming all too familiar. And people becoming numb to the beauty, the wonder, and awe of the gift that was sent to us by God. That's what this Christmas story is about, the gift that was born in a cave in the town of Bethlehem. One of the ways we can keep this story fresh is by researching and discovering new details about the facts of Christ's birth story. I get too excited when a family member does some ancestry digging and discovers something new about my family's heritage. That makes my birth story come alive again. It becomes fresh, and I can't wait to share it with my friends and even with people, new people that I meet. I love sharing my genealogy. It's just fun. And I pray that whatever day your family gathers to celebrate Christmas and open presents, whether it's tonight or tomorrow morning on Christmas Day, I just pray that you make sure to tell the Christmas story with your family. I pray that you will tell it with more details than last year, and that you will tell the story with the awe and wonder and beauty that this story deserves. On the night the Savior was born, in the book of Luke, chapter 2, verse 8, scriptures tell us that the shepherds who were living out in the fields nearby were keeping watch over their flocks of sheep during the night. In Luke chapter 2, verses 9 through 12, it says, "The angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You'll find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.'" Now, can you imagine being a shepherd and tending to your flock late at night, and an angel of the Lord appears to you in all of that shining glory? Can you imagine how you would feel? That would be so cool. That would be terrifying for sure. And then to receive that kind of news. So what exactly about this story is different or exciting or amazing? Well, it says that the shepherds would be given a sign. They would find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Now, the Greek word used for sign that Luke chose refers to a supernatural sign from God that no one could possibly mistake for something else. For example, Jesus walking on water, or the Red Sea parting, or Lazarus being raised from the dead. Those were all obvious signs that it was impossible to mistake them as being from anyone but God. So they said, the angel said that there would be a supernatural sign. The Savior of the world would be wrapped in cloth and lying in a manger. But what? So what? Where's the awe in that? What's so supernatural about that? Well, here's an interesting fact about this story. Is that the shepherds were not your everyday run-of-the-mill shepherds. They were actually classified as Levitical shepherds, which means they were very well trained with the responsibility of caring for the flocks of sheep that were used for sacrifices in the temple in Jerusalem. The sheep used for the sacrifices in the temple were kept in fields nearby the town of Bethlehem. When a ewe was ready to lamb, the shepherds would bring the ewe into one of the caves surrounding Bethlehem that was used for this purpose only. All the birthing caves were kept in a state of ritual purity because the lambs were used for temple sacrifices. So they followed all of the Jewish laws and regulations regarding purity. Many of the male lambs who were born around Bethlehem were actually used for Pesach, or Passover as we know it. So the story in Luke tells us that there was no room in the local inns in Bethlehem at all. So Mary and Joseph actually used one of those ritually purified caves within the area of Bethlehem. So Jesus wasn't born in a wooden stable near an inn or born near someone's house. Jesus, the Savior of the world, was born in a cave that was used for the birth of sacrificial lambs. And Jesus was born in one of those caves because Jesus would become the last sacrificial lamb used for the atonement of our sins for anyone who believes in him as our Savior and Lord. I'm going to show a picture here. Do you see this cave? That's the cave that people suspect Jesus was born in. And here I was trying to bend down so I could enter. And this is at the Church of the Nativity. It also can be called the Basilica. Sometimes they call it the Basilica, Church of the Nativity. You know, there have been a lot of the archways have been made larger because people wanted to ride horses in to see where Christ was born. However, they're trying to preserve it. And so instead of leaving those archways defaced, they went ahead and rebuilt it like it would have been in the time of Christ in order to preserve it. And the inside, the interior looks like this. They suspect that this is the exact place where Jesus was born in Bethlehem, Israel. Bethlehem is located in the West Bank, and it is the oldest church in the Holy Land. Yep, this church located in the West Bank, the Church of the Nativity, or the Basilica of the Nativity, is the oldest church in the Holy Land. It's pretty cool, isn't it? I mean, I think this is incredibly cool. Another little cool detail is they said that another sign that the angel told the shepherds was that they would see the Savior, the lamb born for sacrifice, wrapped in cloths. Now, the significance of this detail is that the Levitical shepherds who were taking care of the lambs to be used in the temple for sacrifices had to be responsible for making sure that the newly born lamb did not contract any defects, because every lamb that was to be used for a sacrifice had to be without spot or blemish. They had to be absolutely perfect. They couldn't have any type of marring on their body at all. So what they did to protect the baby lambs from getting hurt and developing any kind of blemish was to swaddle them or wrap them in cloth so they couldn't play and bump themselves. So they could then be maintained purely and be fit to be used for sacrifices. Now, our Savior was born in the exact place and treated in the exact same way that the temple sacrificial lambs were. And there's one final detail to include in this Christmas story. Just 5 miles north of Bethlehem is the city of Jerusalem. And just outside of Jerusalem, Jesus became the sacrificial lamb as he hung on the cross, bearing the sins of the world. After Jesus was pronounced dead, his body was taken down and once again wrapped in cloth and buried in a tomb awaiting his resurrection 3 days later. So the message from the angel to the shepherds was an announcement that the Savior had been born, and that the evidence of this baby being the Savior is that they would find him in the purified cave, swaddled in cloth, just like all the other lambs that were to be used for sacrifice. So the shepherds knew without a doubt that this lamb born that night was indeed the Lamb of God. John chapter 1, verse 29, it says that John the Baptist saw Jesus walking towards him, and he yelled out, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And that's what the angel was telling the shepherds, and all of us who know the story. The angels were basically saying, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world has been born unto you, and he is Christ the Lord." Now go home and read this story, thinking about these new and important details. Sit around your tree, drink some hot chocolate, and tell this story in love and with excitement as you imagine the power of the announcement from the angel of God to the shepherds all the way across the world in Bethlehem. This is not a boringly familiar story. This is part of the good news of Jesus Christ that is to be cherished in our hearts and needs to be told to people all around the world. Amen. Amen. Please pray, and we'll do our prayer litany. I'll be the leader, and then you all follow Cindy. During the dark, starry night, the Word became flesh. During the dark, starry night, the Word became flesh.
God called us to act. God called us to care. God called us to share this personal story of Christmas, this personal story of salvation.
During the starry night, the Word became flesh.
God sends us into the world to tell the story. The story of God's grace, the story of God's love, the story of God's forgiveness, the story of life everlasting, the story of Jesus, our King, our Lord, our comfort, our Savior, Prince of Peace.
Amen.
again.
No.
Please stand if you're able and join us in this beautiful song. Please remain standing. Before we close with the benediction, I'd like to invite you all to stay if you're able to have some refreshments out in the narthex. And may God's love and the good news of Jesus Christ be with all of you and also with you. Thank you. Amen. And now go and share the good news. Jesus is born. Hallelujah.